we want to write the system of equations as an augmented matrix and then solve the system by writing the matrix in row echelon form. Notice we have a system of three linear equations with three unknowns. The equations are in standard form, meaning we have the x, y, and z terms on the left and the constants on the right. So we're ready to write the augmented matrix. Looking at the first equation, the first row of the matrix will be 1, 2, negative 3, negative 2. The second row will be 2, negative 3, 1, 5. And the third row will be negative 2, negative 4, 6, 4. Now to write this in row echelon form, we can use this as a guide. Let's go ahead and review the specifics about row echelon form. The first non-zero element in each row, called the leading entry, must be 1. Each leading entry is in a column to the right of the leading entry in the previous row, and rows with all zero elements, if any, are below rows having a non-zero element. Looking at the examples of the matrices in row echelon form, notice how the main diagonal often consists only of ones, though it can contain a zero if we have infinite or no solutions, and all the elements below the main diagonal must be zero. To write a matrix in row echelon form, we'll perform Gaussian elimination, which means any two rows can be interchanged, the elements of any row can be multiplied by a non-zero real number, and any row can be changed by adding or subtracting the corresponding elements with another row. So going back to our example, we're going to focus on obtaining zeros in these three positions. If we focus on row 2 and row 3, notice that in column 1, the elements are opposites, which means if we replace row 3 with row 3 plus row 2, we would obtain a zero in this position. So let's go ahead and do this as our first step. We'll keep the first two rows the same. And now for row 3, we'll have row 3 plus row 2, so negative 2 plus 2 is 0. Negative 4 plus negative 3 is negative 7. 6 plus 1 is 7. And 4 plus 5 is 9. Now let's obtain a 0 in this position. Let's go ahead and use row 1. Notice if this element here was negative 2, we could add it to positive 2 to obtain 0. So let's go ahead and replace row 2 with negative 2 times row 1 plus row 2. So we'll keep the first and third rows the same for right now. And now for row 2, we'll have negative 2 times 1 plus 2, that's 0. Negative 2 times 2, that's negative 4, plus negative 3, that's negative 7. And then we have negative 2 times negative 3, that's 6, plus 1, that's positive 7. And then we have negative 2 times negative 2, that's positive 4, plus 5, which is positive 9. Now let's obtain a zero in this position here, so that we have a lower triangle of zeros, which we need for row echelon form. We don't want to lose the zero in column 1, so we can't use row 1, we have to use row 2, which also contains a zero in column 1. And since both rows contain negative 7 in column 2, let's go ahead and replace row 3 with negative 1 times row 2 plus row 3. We could subtract them, but I prefer to add, making the elements opposites. So again, the first two rows stay the same. And now for row 3, we'll have negative 1 times 0 plus 0 is still 0. Negative 1 times negative 7, that's positive 7, plus negative 7, that's 0. For the next column, we have negative 1 times 7, that's negative 7, plus positive 7, that's also 0. And then for the fourth column, we have negative 1 times 9, that's negative 9, plus 9, that's also 0. So notice in this case, we have a row of zeros, which for row echelon form must be in the last row, which it is. This also indicates that our system has an infinite number of solutions, which we'll discuss more in just a moment. Remember, if this is going to be in row echelon form, the first non-zero element must be positive 1, so we need to replace row 2 with negative 1/7 times row 2, so this element here would be positive 1. So the first and third rows will stay the same. Now for row 2, the first element will still be 0. Then we have negative 1/7 times negative 7, that's 1. negative 1 seventh times 7, that's negative 1. Negative 1 seventh times 9 would be negative 9 sevenths. Now that we have this in row echelon form, we're going to write this back as a system of equations. And then we'll understand why this system has an infinite number of solutions based upon having a row of zeros. This first column gives us the equation 1x plus 2y minus 3z equals negative 2, or just x plus 2y minus 3z equals negative 2. The second equation tells us that 0x plus 1y minus 1z equals negative 9 sevenths, or y minus z equals negative 9 sevenths. And then finally, this last row is telling us that 0x plus 0y plus 0z equals 0, or that 0 equals 0. When we obtain an equation like this that does not contain variables, it's either going to be always true or always false. Well, 0 is always equal to 0, so therefore this is a true statement indicating that we have an infinite number of solutions. Now, this does not mean that any value for x, y, and z would satisfy this system. X, y, and z are still related in a specific way, so we're often asked to express a relationship among x, y, and z using parametric equations. We take a look at our second equation here, where we have y minus z equals negative 9 sevenths. Notice if we solve this equation for y, we would have y equals negative 9 sevenths plus z, or z minus 9 sevenths. Notice how this equation expresses a relationship between z and y. So now if we introduce a new variable, let's say t, where t is any real number, if we let z equal t, we could also say that y is equal to t minus 9 sevenths. Now we just need an equation for x in terms of t, and we can find one by using these two equations and performing substitution into our first equation here that says x plus 2y minus 3z equals negative 2. Let's go ahead and do this on the next slide. So we'll have x plus 2 times y, where y is t minus 9 sevenths, minus 3z, where z is equal to t, must equal negative 2. So we'll have x plus 2t minus, this would be what, 18 sevenths, minus 3t equals negative 2. Combining like terms, we have x 2t minus 3t, so we have x minus t minus 18 sevenths equals negative 2. Solve this for x, so we'll add t to both sides and add 18 sevenths to both sides. So we'll have x equals t plus 18 sevenths, and then minus 2, but minus 2, or 2 over 1, is equal to minus 14 sevenths. So we have x equals t plus 4 sevenths. So even though we have an infinite number of solutions, we can express our solution parametrically in this form here. So for any value of t, these equations would give us a value for x, y, and z that would satisfy the system of equations. And of course, if we wanted to, we could express this as an ordered triple, where the first coordinate would be t plus 4 sevenths, the second coordinate would be t minus 9 sevenths, the third coordinate would be t, where t is any real number. So because we have an infinite number of solutions, we can say our system is consistent and dependent. If we graph this, these three planes will have an infinite number of points on all three planes. Let's finish by looking at the graph. Here's the graph of the three planes. Two of the planes are actually the same plane. That's why this one plane looks both yellow and blue. But notice how they intersect in this black line. And since there's an infinite number of points on a line, that's the reason why we have an infinite number of solutions. Okay, I hope you found this explanation helpful.